Back in the mid-2010s, I had some pretty good luck doing odd jobs on Craigslist. They were mostly landscaping jobs that paid decently most of the time, and my full-time gig allowed me a lot of free time, so this was a great way for me to make some side money and also be outside. On a Monday, I answered an ad for a landscaping job on a Friday. I started communicating with a woman, and we eventually exchanged numbers, and the way she was texting seemed almost flirtatious. Her name was Tracy, and after she told me about the job, she continued texting me, asking very probing questions like, "How big are your muscles? I hope you're able to lift all this mulch." And she would accompany all these messages with some smiling emojis. At the time, being a single guy, in my early 20s, I loved the attention. I have to say, I'm not the best at picking up the signs though, but I felt like it was obvious at this point that she was flirting with me. I started to roll the dice more with my messages back, and I tried to see how far I could take the conversation without going over the line. It was becoming clear to me that there was no line though. We texted that entire night and continued texting throughout the entire week. It was crazy, I admit that, but the weirdness of the situation was kinda hot for me. But in the middle of the week, the flirting evolved into something much more personal. She started sending me pictures of her posing in the kitchen and doing that duck face. I don't even know if girls still do that, but back then, all the girls did the duck face. We started sharing details about herself, and she told me that she was divorced and now single. She said that she was 37 years old, and I loved the idea of talking to an older woman, just as she admitted that she loved talking to a younger guy. We texted non-stop for days, and we even made a plan for Friday night after the landscaping job. She told me that I could shower at her place, and let's just say that she implied much, much more. I'd never been more excited to do a landscaping job in my life, to be honest. On Friday morning, the day of the job, she texted me and said that she would be at work when I got there, but everything I would need was in the backyard in the shed. After that text, I never got another message from her for the entire day, which was kind of weird. And I'm not kidding when I tell you that I messaged this girl all day every day since Monday, so not hearing from her was kind of strange. I messaged her a few times just to see how she was doing and see if we were still hanging out after the job, but like I said, no answer. All day long, I couldn't shake the thought that I had been catfished all week. Some creep was probably messaging me pretending to be a woman. And by 4 in the afternoon, I was just about done with the job, and since I hadn't heard from Tracy, I had given up hope that she was even a real person. Not 5 minutes later, I felt a jolt of excitement as I saw a green sedan pull into the driveway, and I couldn't believe my eyes. It was Tracy, the same woman from all the pictures on my phone. I smiled, but she didn't even look at me and just parked and walked inside the house. I started walking to the house, and then this big white truck pulled in behind Tracy's car. The driver got out aggressively and stormed into the house. He was a huge man, like very muscular huge, and he looked almost like a professional wrestler, even like a pro football player. He was bald, but he had that sort of clean bald look. I had no idea what was happening, but no matter what, I had to go inside so I could get paid for all this work. The front door was open, and only the screen door was shut. I sort of shouted through the screen that I was finished with the work and that I was coming inside to meet Tracy for the payment. I entered the screen, and as I walked a few feet into the house, the large man moved in behind me, standing in front of the screen door. Tracy emerged from the room in front of me, and in a very hysterical voice, she shouted, "That's the guy, babe. That's the creep from Craigslist who won't stop texting me." This giant man started stepping to me and cussing me out for hitting on his wife. I immediately went into self-defense mode and shouted, "Whoa, man, she told me she was single. I got the messages to prove it." The guy paused for a second, looking at me, and I could hear Tracy shouting, "Liar," behind me. And while she was screaming, the man started to get hot, and he started screaming at her. Before I knew it, I was in the middle of an argument that I didn't want to be in. Tracy continued to call me a liar, among many other things, and at the same time was yelling at the large man. Tracy's husband effortlessly pushed me out of the way and aggressively made his way towards her. When he was just inches away, she pulled out from behind her back one of those sort of meat tenderizers, I think it was. It was almost like a spiked mallet thing that some people might have in their kitchen, and she strikes him in the head. And it must have been a pretty good shot because he fell over instantly. He tried to get up, but couldn't get up off his knees. He just stood there, clutching his head in pain. I kept shouting, asking if he was okay, but he wasn't saying anything. I was so confused. And I looked up, and now Tracy started running at me with that mallet in her hand. And without thinking, I just kick at her towards her ankle or something, causing her to fall on her face. And while both these freaking psychos are on the ground, I ran out of the house. And once I drove off, I called the police, telling them everything that had happened. And from what I know, they did arrest Tracy that evening, but I don't think the husband pressed charges, though. That man, who was no saint, I might add, eventually paid me for the work that I did. And in hindsight, I just think I was an innocent victim of a very toxic relationship that hit a very strong boiling point. In many ways, it's a good thing that I was there and called the police when I did, because if I didn't, who knows what Tracy or her husband could have done to one another, or worse, what they could have done to somebody else if they answered that ad instead of me.
Hey guys, thanks so much for all the support. If you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, please feel free to do so.
Calling strangers over your house when you're alone is a big dumb move, since you knowing for sure if they are a good person or not isn't an option when it's the first time you've met them. Anyway, I have learned this the hard way. So now I'm trying to warn others for doing something stupid before they end up regretting it. My house is pretty big for someone who lives in solitude. My daughters used to be here to fill it up with their laughs and chatters, but ever since I sent them off to the university hostel, it had become quite lonely. I married at the age of 21, when I was first pregnant with Louise. While my marriage was mostly because of my baby, I still felt grateful toward Kent when he was man enough to take me as his responsibility, when he couldn't just deny it, saying it was a silly mistake on his part. As time passed, I grew to love my husband, watching him to be a good, responsible dad, and I'm sure he felt the same way, looking at the amount of love he showered me with. 2 years into our marriage, and I was once again pregnant with Avery, and he lavished me with gifts. He didn't let me lift a single finger throughout the pregnancy, and was always there for my every single need. Man, oh man, if this man could get any more lovable and charming, I don't know if you'd believe me, but even in that condition, I would get wildly turned on by his simple gestures. Even after the delivery, he didn't change one bit, and not even 2 more years later. The man continued making me feel like the most loved woman on the planet, even as our daughters started to grow older and join school, until one day, he received a great opportunity from one of the biggest companies. It was basically his dream job, but he was hesitating to accept it since he would need to move to a different country to work, and we had built up our lives here. I tried talking to the girls to see if they wanted to move, but they strongly opposed it, and I saw his face drop in sadness. After dinner, as the two of us were in the kitchen doing dishes together, I turned to him, grabbed his hand, and said, "You should go." He looked at me in confusion, trying to figure out if I wanted him out of the kitchen or something. "You need to move to Mexico for the job, right?" The moment I said that, his eyes lit up for a few seconds. "I cannot leave you and the kids behind all alone." He turned back to put the dishes in the washer as we were done cleaning them by hand. "We won't have to be alone. I'll take care of the kids. Besides, I won't let you spend a single holiday there." I turned him toward me and hugged him. "I won't. I promise to be at home at every single one of them." I could feel him smile while dropping tears as he hugged me back. The man has almost sacrificed his life to make me and the kids happy through and through. So why couldn't I be the bigger person for once and let him pursue his dream? I was confident that at the end of the day, this man would be back in my arms because we were his home. He accepted the offer and had to move to Mexico within 15 days. Everything went so fast that it felt like a dream, but once he was gone, it felt too real. He kept his promise and never missed coming home on a holiday with trunks full of gifts for girls, and he would always say he missed me to death. Every time we made love felt like the first time, the longing, the craving. It all made it more exciting each time. But once he was gone, time would feel as if it was at a halt, if not for the girls making me busy with their shenanigans. Then finally came the day when both of them were accepted to the universities and went off to stay in the hostel. Sending them off was the hardest thing I had to do, even harder than when I sent my husband, because then I knew that I would have my children to keep my mind occupied. But once my girls were gone too, I became completely alone. Kent asked me over the phone calls multiple times if I was doing okay, and since I didn't want to worry him, I kept saying I was. I started to become used to the loneliness with time and kept my head busy with housework and my hobby, which was shoe designing. As I mentioned earlier, my house was big, so there was a lawn surrounded by beautiful plants, which was my doing due to boredom. There was a pipe leakage recently, so the lawn pipe, which was making it problematic for me. I tried talking to a few local plumbers, but they all said they needed to dig up the pipe to check the main issue. And since I didn't want to destroy my beautiful lawn, I was trying to look for an alternative. That was when I went on Craigslist and found a contact number of a handyman. I tried calling him, and unlike other plumbers, he picked up on the second ring. I explained the situation, and he told me that it would be solved easily without the need to dig up anything. It came as a relief to me at the time, thinking my lawn wouldn't have to suffer the consequences of the leaked pipe. I mean, the guy said that it was a relatively simple job to do. I had no idea about any of that stuff, so whatever he gave me, I simply ate it up and believed him. The appointment was set for tomorrow, and I mentioned the address along with lines that it would be hard for him to find it, so he needed to give a call before heading out for me to share my location. First thing in the morning the next day, I received a phone call from him as he told me he was outside. I looked at the time and it was 7 in the morning. Even my birds weren't awake yet, but still, I thought the dude must be completely dedicated to his work. Instead of being shocked and creeped out by the fact that he found my house just with that rough address, I was impressed. I buzzed him in and showed him to the lawn, but instead of taking a look at the leaked pipe, he said he needed to look around other pipes as well to check the actual problem. The way he was inspecting the pipes, he seemed legit, so I let him do his work and went ahead to get freshened up, as I had just been woken up by this guy. As I got out of bed, I was shocked to see him inside the bedroom checking every single thing. It alarmed me. "What are you doing?" I asked in a hesitant voice. "Ma'am, do you have a wrench?" He knew I saw him, but the abrupt change of subject disconcerted me. "Yes, but you could have waited out in the hall to ask me that." My displeased voice made him change his expression, which I noticed from the corner of my eye as I exited the bedroom, and he followed me. Asking him to stay right here in the kitchen, I went to the storeroom to get what he asked for, but as I was looking for the wrench, I felt a presence right behind me. He was standing so close to me that I could feel his breathing over me. I was so panicked that I could not speak for a few seconds as my hands were in the drawer. I touched something very metallic and grabbed it immediately, making myself ready to defend in case the creep pulled anything. "Ma'am, did you find the wrench?" he asked in a deep, heavy voice which sent chills down my spine. At this point, I didn't want to give him something he could use to kill me, so I shook my head no. "Can you wait outside while I look?" I asked in a slow, trembling voice as my words barely came out of my mouth. "No, I'll stay here," he replied. At this point, I was too terrified to continue looking, so I pulled whatever I found in the drawer and made a run for it. As I got outside the house, I called my neighbor Mark over right away and told him that the man was weird. He asked him to leave, but the man said he wouldn't leave until he fixed the pipe and gets his payment for that, and despite several threats received by my neighbor, he still fixed the pipe. Mark was there the entire time that handyman did his work, and when I handed him the money, as he was leaving, he kept giving me a creepy stare, but instead of that, he did nothing else. I thanked Mark for his help as he left, and went inside my home, locking every single door behind me. I was too scared to not tell Ken about everything, even though I didn't want to make him worry. He He suggested that I don't call anyone inside any longer, and that if there's anything that needs repair, he would do it because he'd be coming back for a long vacation. I was finally able to sleep after hearing his reassuring words. Nothing out of the ordinary happened after that, nor did I ever see that man, or heard from him, which is a relief, but I still sometimes wonder what would have happened if Mark didn't come. Was there an ulterior motive he was hiding, or was he just that creepy? Even if he had no intention of harming me, there were too many red flags for me to ignore.
I don't want to be too specific with details here, but I'm sure you'll understand why I'm wise to being a bit paranoid by the end of this. I've been into urban exploring, or urbex as people are calling it these days, for just as long as I can remember. I think it all stems from being an extreme introvert, how when other kids were playing together on jungle gyms and swing sets, I preferred being off of my own, exploring some hidden corner of the park or wherever we were. By the time I was a teenager, I was cracking bigger and bigger targets, traveling across town on my bike on weekends to tag derelicts with a can of spray paint. Then in my 20s, I was traveling across the Northeast to hit up some classics, as well as some lesser known derps that hadn't been scouted out all that well. But I definitely had two or three haunts in my hometown I'd hit up once or twice a year, just to see how they were progressing, so to speak. It's more like degressing, actually, but you get my point. Buildings would accumulate filth, become home to animals, maybe people. You'd get graffiti artists coming in and out. It was nice seeing them age. Of all the places I'd thought I'd come closest to losing my life, it definitely wasn't in my local Toads. I knew them like the back of my hand, and they were my favorite because they were relatively safe. But anyway, on with the story. I'm wandering around this big old industrial complex, marveling at how Mother Nature seemed to be slowly taking it back, one cracked paving slab at a time. I stopped to eat some sandwiches I'd packed with me, sitting up in the office of an old factory that looked over the shop floor. All the glass was smashed out, and I'm just sitting in the filthy old chair trying to eat as cleanly as possible when I suddenly begin to hear voices. At first, I start to worry, thinking it might be security or even the cops. I didn't think the place had any active cameras, or that I'd been spotted by anyone on duty, so I'm kind of angry at myself for slipping, at least until I hear the voices getting louder and louder. They didn't sound like cops at all, but they were definitely headed into the building that I was in. The only question was, what were they doing there? But unfortunately for me, it wasn't long before I found out. This isn't exactly what they said, just a close approximation from memory, but here it goes. Guy 1.
I'm telling you, man, this is bad news. They got him with 12 keys and he's gonna roll on us.
Guy 2.
We can get him county, that's not the problem. It's the names he drops between now and then, the ones that can get back to us.
Guy 1.
But do we even know who he's named? We can't just rub out 6 guys assuming they're all gonna turn states.
Guy 2.
We don't have a choice.
Guy 3.
He's right. There are almost $500,000 at stake here. We can't afford to take chances. Everyone has to go.
Guy 1.
Wait. You gotta be kidding me. We're gonna rub out 6 of our own guys?
Guy 3.
You heard what I said. Get it done. Anyone who knows, get it done.
I couldn't believe what I was hearing. Some kind of murderous criminal conspiracy, possibly over drugs or other illegal imports, and it was going down just meters away from me. Now try to think of the worst thing that could possibly happen at that point. Outside of the world getting hit by an asteroid, what's the one thing you wouldn't want to happen in that situation? For those of you that answered, my phone suddenly going off, then ding ding ding, right answer. Because right as these guys were about to leave, I got a call. I didn't even see who it was. I just mashed the lower volume button to silence the ringtone, then heard,
"Who's that? Who's there?"
before the sound of running.
I ran harder and faster than I ever had in my life. If it wasn't for the fact that I knew the place like the back of my hand, I might not be here telling you all this today. I was so scared that I didn't even go home that night. I just went to another of my favorite toads and hung out there until morning, only leaving when I was certain that I wasn't being followed. In retrospect, I don't think they saw my face or anything, and they probably thought I was an undercover narc or something, I don't know. But nothing ever came of the incident, and I had no idea who the guys were to be able to follow their case in the news or whatever. It was definitely the scariest thing that's ever happened to me while urbexing, though. And it's taught me to, overall, expect the unexpected.